So, hello everybody. It's always hard to be first after lunch, so everybody has full stomach, is getting sleepy. So, let's see. Keep the content coming and hope it is interesting for you, to you. At least until the break. Okay, my topic is cloud native application management needs simple, flexible, and reliable tooling. There is no word about PaaS, but because I'm the lead of the platform as a service research in the lab, typically if we talk about cloud native applications, at least if I talk about cloud native applications, I talk about cloud native application running on platform as a service. You could also implement cloud native applications on infrastructure as a service, but this whole talk is about running these applications, these kind of applications on platforms. We had a lot of talks already about platforms, advantages, disadvantages, how to implement them, etc. There will be other talks coming in the afternoon, more focusing on PaaS. For me, it was interesting to see the first Open Cloud Day, I think 80% of the topics was infrastructure as a service and networking. And now, I think it's shifted quite a bit. It's more than half is about platform as a service, and only a smaller part is about infrastructure as a service. Okay. PaaS. PaaS for me is a blessing for developers, because it's super simple to deploy your application, to provision your services. You can update your applications, extend your application without any downtime. You can scale up, scale down, and I don't need a real operations team. Operations team is operating the platform, and as a developer, as a business, as a manager of an application, I can focus on the code, on business functionality, and to bring the functionality as fast as possible to my customers, and so get fast feedback, get an advantage over my competitors, produce better applications. Yeah. So for me as a developer, I do not want to bother with infrastructure. I do not want to configure VMs. I have no interest on configuring a MySQL server or squeeze out the last bit of an Apache web server. So, all the resilience and scalability functionality is built into the platform. And if I choose an open source implementation, I also have a large choice of providers and deployment models. I can use a public platform from different providers, or I can use my private installation, my private PaaS, if it's important for me regarding security, cost, because public cloud may become more expensive if you go to larger applications. If I push my application, push or deploy, or git push, cf push, depending on your cloud you are implementing, my platform will take over. I have my runtime management system, which creates my containers, which manages my containers, scales up. Then it's deploying, provisioning my runtimes, it's provisioning my middleware, setting up my network and my routes, etc. I can attach services on demand and create scale services on demand here on the right side, the services side. And everything is supervised by a health manager. So if my application dies, or an instance of my application dies for some reason, Health Manager kicks in and starts the applications. So I do not have to bother with monitoring my instances. I still have to watch if instances always fail, maybe something is wrong with my code, but at the end, much less trouble, much less effort needed to run my applications. Okay, but to run applications or provide or publish applications to the cloud. I cannot just take my old application and push it. I need to design my application for running in the cloud. I need to adapt the application. I need to design it so my application can scale elastically, horizontal scaling. And I also need to design my application, the architecture of my application, to be resilient. The platform helps me with this by restarting my containers, but if a service dies or a service takes too long to respond, I have to add some features or some implement some patterns so the service or the end user has a reasonable response in portable time. Okay, for this, typical best practices are to use the cloud native application patterns like circuit breaker, application gateways, etc., just to make sure that your application is available and is responsible. And another important component is to follow the 12-factor application principles, which you can read on the 12-factor net application. So we will see later in the talk some of these principles are very important also for the tooling on top. If you are using tooling to manage your applications, to manage to deploy your application, if your tooling supports these 12-factor principles, and if your application is using it, then it is a very good match. So for instance, you should version all your code, and you should also version all your configurations. Very simple and easy principle. You should declare dependencies explicitly. No unmentioned dependency. The dependencies from one application to another application to a service should be declared somewhere in the configuration. And you should also see if the dependency is not fulfilled, then your deployment process should stop and give you a warning. Etc., etc. These are 12 principles. You can follow them, read them on the net. Okay, so you create your application, you're following your applications are now designed for the cloud. They are cloud native design, implementing cloud native design. Then it's very easy to deploy it, to scale it. Very easy to deploy a single application. All the cloud infrastructures, the cloud platforms are built just to push the single application and monitor your single applications. But there is another trend also in this kind of applications, the trend towards microservice applications. Microservice applications will split up your monolith in smaller components, independent, loosely coupled services, which are organized around business capabilities. So your application will be much more modular. You can much easier upgrade or replace a single component. You don't have to deploy the whole monolith again. Just one component of your applications can be upgraded with a new version, all the rest running with the older versions, etc. It makes your development process much easier to manage if you follow these principles. Okay. Also, one important part is that these microservice architectures up your data model. So you don't have one large common shared data model anymore. So each microservice usually has then its own data model and is using its own service, its own data store, so independent of the other microservices. So it's also easier then to manage the individual data stores, easier to manage the individual components. They are easy to understand, easy to deploy, and also easier to find errors. But there's a backside or a negative side also of this. You are externalizing the complexity of your application. So the complexity is not inside your application or inside your service, it is between your services. You have multiple services which depend on each other, and then you are some kind of externalized piece. And another disadvantage of microservices is that you get a much larger, a huge number of components and services to be maintained. Consider when you deploy your application, seriously deploy your applications, you do not deploy directly to production. You usually have one or multiple development environments to develop the features, to develop new versions, etc. For your developers. Then using kind of integration testing, you will have a testing environment to run components of your applications. Finally, before going public, you have at least one staging environment or multiple testing environments. You have at least a staging environment to really check the whole application if it still works, and also perform acceptance tests, performance tests, etc. Finally, if everything works well so far, you can go automatically or by hand deploy to production. And hopefully, it should work well. Everything should work well. If you see this, you see there's a huge inflation of services you need. In each environment, you need specific. You need all the services to run all your components of your microservices. So it's multiplying the required resources. You need also much more space to run your applications. The number of components to be maintained, to be managed, to be configured is increasing dramatically. Then it's also important to see that you have service interdependencies, so one service depends on another service, which does make the deployment process not easier, and it also makes the configuration management more complex. We had the pleasure, in our lab to get asked by Kaba, because they are developing a nice, I think everybody knows Kaba in Switzerland, the major provider of security and access services for buildings. They are developing a new product, which is called Kaba XEVO, which is basically access control as a service. So access control, instead of on your dedicated system within the company, it is now, you can do it, it's now on the cloud. I think I cannot go into details. I don't want to explain you how this works. It's quite a complex application. It's built in two layers. We have an IoT layer, which is connecting to the backend components, to the IoT components, so the devices, to the locks. There's also a kind of a black box, which is the access manager, which runs the IoT, networking and IoT processes when the internet connection goes down, for example. So your local devices still work without connection to the cloud. This is everything to do hardware-based, very secure, timing-sensitive. And the second part is the application layer, which has all the customer partner applications, management applications for Kaba, manage your business, manage your logs, manage your customers, and there is also the whole business domain, the whole business domain logic processes are in this area. It started maybe small, but it grew to quite size. The application layer consists or the consisted a few months back of 50 applications. These 50 applications were using 48 services, and to be resilient, there were multiple instances of the applications running, so around about 150 instances of the applications were running. On the IoT layer, it was 30 applications, 18 services, and 90 instances running. So around about 80 applications to be managed. And each of these environments were available in a development environment, in multiple testing environments, staging environment, in a production environment. So, the main challenges of the team was then that it was very difficult to keep the overview of all the apps and all the services. It took them with each application added, the effort to do the maintenance, to adapt the scripts, check all the configurations, etc., was increasing. And finally, it was also slow and sometimes unreliable to deploy. If some configuration was not correct, the whole deployment got stuck. It was also at this point in time, the platform was not so stable. Services were not all running smoothly. And this was also a problem because if you have very simple scripts and have deployed 30 services and the 31st is not working, so the whole deployment fails. Okay. The environment to deploy applications is not simply the cloud directly. You usually have a whole environment of systems running to do your deployments. For example, you have a continuous deployment, continuous integration server, you have your code repository, you have a configuration service where you store your version configurations. For Carbide is also important to have a secure store to store all the passwords and credentials and certificates. So the certificates were not in the configuration server in clear text, but in a securely maintained separate storage. And also artifact repositories where you store your compiled resources, so you don't have to compile every time. If nothing has changed in source code. And finally, you need your cloud. In case of Carbide, it was the Swisscom application cloud, which is based on Cloud Foundry. We'll hear a presentation after this talk, Swisscom, which shows you how this application works and what they are offering. Okay, this is more or less the environment, the context of this tooling. And we had the pleasure to implement a prototype for this. And to implement these prototypes, we were looking into several options. The simplest option was to use basic shell scripts. In fact, Carbide itself implemented a kind of quite flexible modular shell script to deploy their applications for development and also deploy on the CI/CD server. But then the script on the CI/CD server was different than the deployment on the local developer workstations, etc. So it was difficult to maintain. This works for small installation, for small applications. Then there is this huge ecosystem of so-called cloud app management and orchestration tools. Starting with Chef, Puppet, maybe what's now hot and trendy?
Salt.
I think every second week there is another deployment and application configuration management tool showing up. Problem with these tools is they are basically, or almost all of them are to 95% infrastructure focused. So they deploy, they log into your containers or to your virtual machines, deploy software, configure your Apache, blah, etc., etc. They have limited support for application layer, but basically it's only deploy this application, deploy this component, start this service, etc. This kind of very simple kind of functions which are implemented, so only the minimal set of functions which are implemented for platforms. And no support for migrating applications or versioning of applications. Okay, this was not an option. Next was the idea you could build it into the CI/CD system. Same here, there are plugins which are supporting Cloud Foundry, there are plugins which are supporting OpenShift, there are plugins for Kubernetes, for different CI/CD systems. But still, if you, they are basically also focused on one application. So one application to be deployed, one component deployed, one service, etc. So no combination of anything. And then you have to script it yourself. You have to implement the architecture of your application
in
the CI/CD system. And if you change your CI/CD system, you can implement it again. Then, what a nice option to be would the platform itself provides this. The platform itself knows the architecture of your application. The platform has the tooling. All this is. There are some services on top of platforms which are doing this as a service. They are limited for complex microservice applications or for sizes of applications. And also here. You have to maintain this redundant model of your application. And then you're logged in again to the platform if you want to change the platform. And there are also some commercial deployment automation tools, systems, which are basically, or usually not open source. And at least those I know are quite expensive. So you have to go through the So, this was the environment we found, and what we also found is that almost every company was implementing their own tooling system. So, every company was taking something, adopting it, changing it, tweaking it for their needs. So, there was no generic tooling system. Okay, so we created the prototype, which was successful. This prototype was then re-implemented again from Kaba because they have better development skills in Node. Prototype and also the system is written in Node. And finally, Kaba basically has released it 2 months ago in open source, and we called it Push to Cloud. And the remaining part of this presentation, I will show how this push to cloud is working. Well, push to cloud is an application management deployment toolkit. It's not a fixed system. It's a toolkit which is modular. You can extend it yourself. You can use the models you want to use or don't use them. It has a sophisticated application configuration management. And what we added to the normal tooling, we added releases and deployments. So we created a system of a release. We decided, okay, a release is a specific set of application in a specific version. And we said, okay, this release can be deployed to multiple environments. So we have defined a deployment is then deploying a release to a specific environment, also to this cloud, also to the development environment or to the testing environment or to the production environment. So for each of them, this is then called a deployment. The whole tool is platform agnostic. We created it so modular that we can easily create a new adapter for different platforms. Currently, the only implementation is for Cloud Foundry. And it's independent of your application language or of your application architecture. So you can deploy your Java application, you can deploy or manage your Go application, etc. flexible, customizable, all the workflows. I will come to this. And as I said, it's open source. In push to cloud consists basically of four steps to bring your cloud to bring your application to the cloud. First of all, you will manage your configuration and your deployment files in a repository version. Also, your source code is in the repository. Push to cloud will load your applications and your configuration script. It will also check out your application code. You can then run for each of your applications. You can start specific build scripts, invoke build scripts, finalize your application, to package your application, etc. And finally, it will deploy the application to the platform. In the current case, it's Cloud Foundry. Configuration management, I already explained this a bit. We defined deployments and releases. So a deployment is a deployment of the whole system. It could be 80 applications to a specific environment. In Cloud Foundry, this is usually defined as a space. There, all the specific components, all the specific configuration for a specific environment is part of the deployment manifest. And then in the deployment manifest, I also will specify which release will be deployed. A release is basically a list of applications of a specific version, not more. And this list of applications is then, for each application, you have an application manifest where you specify specific parameters for this application. So how much space, for how much RAM does it use, what services does it need, what dependencies on other applications does it have, these kind of parameters. And you will also specify service bindings and application dependencies. This is an important part which we added to this application manifest. From these configuration files, each application maintainer will create an application manifest. The release manager, more or less, is maintaining the release manifest. And if you want to deploy something, you create a deployment. Simple by its structure. As soon as you deploy your application to a specific environment, we will then take the deployment manifest and compile a deployment configuration. So we will more or less merge all the application manifests, release manifests, and deployment configuration into one larger file, which represents then the desired state. This is on the next slide. We take the application manifests, release manifests, and configure it with the parameters which are in the deployment manifest, and compile it to this deployment configuration. It's human readable, but it's not meant to be read by humans. But you can still check. If you think you find an error, you can quite easily read this deployment configuration. The nice thing, and this deployment configuration is the desired state of your system, which it should be after deployment. The nice thing is now also we can go to the platform and retrieve the current application configuration from the specific environment and create, in the same structure, we can also create a deployment configuration from the running system, from the actual running system, which we then call the actual state. And this, at the end, allows us to compare, make a diff from the desired state to the actual state, and then from this decide what we have to do to bring the system, the online system, to the desired state, from the actual to the desired state. And to do this, we implemented a nice workflow framework. It's not a workflow engine, it's a framework. because the workflows here are imperative by design, so it's code, it's not a declarative workflow. You write your workflow in code. They are easy to code, you can extend it, it's JavaScript. Workflows are running asynchronously. It's functional design, as typical Node.js programming. And we have also built-in controlled parallel operations, so you don't overload your system if you deploy 50 applications at the same time. You can limit the parallel operations. And we also added in some reliability features like timeouts, retries, and grace periods. So if you start your application, we will check for a certain amount of time if it runs stable. And declare it only as deployed if it runs stable. So details about workflow internals. This is kind of an example of a blue-green deployment. It's very, very, very simple blue-green deployment workflow, where we see we have desired configuration. We get the actual state, the deployment configuration, actual state. And then from this difference, we see which apps has to be pushed, or which new apps have to be pushed. Then we can switch the URL to the new applications. And we can then delete the old versions of the applications. So it's a very simple variant of the deployment workflow. And such a workflow looks then like this. Even if you are not a programmer, you can still kind of read what's happening within such a workflow. Here we are packaging the applications, that we are creating services,
we are creating
routes, we are creating the applications, we are uploading applications, we are setting the environments. Staging the applications means
we are creating the
containers. Binding the applications to services and start them.
Then switch the new version of
the application, stop the old application,
and clean up.
So,
find an easy
way to declare your application. And if it doesn't fit your workflow, you can adopt it,
modify it, create yours.
Okay. Very fast. As I said, it's modular. Then easily integrated into a CI/CD system. It's the command line based. You can just call the command line from your CI/CD system. And we have also a CF adapter, so if you want to use it for OpenShift, you have to write an OpenShift adapter, and the same functionality can be used also with OpenShift. Outcomes, faster deployments, more than 2 times faster.
We have also more reliable
deployments. Very flexible and extensible. My last slide. A push to cloud, as I said, is open source. You can check it out. There's also a demo application. Just check out the instructions how to deploy the demo application. You can also contribute, get in contact with us. And
specifically
for you today, this evening,
you can meet the
developers of Push to Cloud, you can ask them, you can get more details. We even offer to Push to Cloud
application,
also modify your application,
to work with Push to Cloud in a workshop this evening in the
Cloud Foundry group after the Open Cloud Day in the same room here. Or just if you don't have time this evening,
come to our room
outside in the foyer and check the demo.
That's it. So these are the participated companies which are working or contributing
to Push to Cloud. Based importantly, Donald initiated and paid. Any questions?